Diana, Princess of Wales, became a member of the royal family through marriage and lost the title Her Royal Highness with her divorce. But it was a quality within herself that enabled her to transcend the usual boundaries of fame, to become a star, perhaps even an icon. John Simpson analyses the quality which led the French President Jacques Chirac today to call Diana a woman of our age.
She wasn't just a star of our time, she was the star of our time. The most famous woman in the world, bar none. Her image, whether as a princess or a queen of fashion, or the heroine of a universal soap opera, or someone who befriended the poor and sick, was known in every single country in the world. As for the cameras, they could never take their eyes off her. At first, back in 1980, the fascination was merely to get a sight of the shy young woman who was going to marry the heir to the throne. She was gawky, and the contrast with the later fashion icon was total. Those were innocent days, comparatively. Even so, a picture of her in a see-through dress was enough to send the tabloids into a frenzy. It was very hard for a young woman of the 80s, a commoner, to fit into the tight restrictions the royal family were obliged to impose on themselves. She had to be young because the future queen couldn't turn out to have a past. Her husband-to-be did have a past, and it came to haunt their marriage. Maybe with hindsight, the signs were already there.
And I'm amazed that she's been brave enough to take me on.
And I suppose in love.
Of course.
Whatever in love means.
But the fairy tale was still in place. Their wedding was the most lavish and spectacular ever, and the princess caught precisely the mood and fashion of the time in her hairstyle, her dress, her whole appearance. It was the effective start of her reign as a queen of fashion. There wouldn't be too many days as happy as this. Even their honeymoon wasn't entirely happy, partly thanks to all the media attention. Later, both prince and princess agreed in different ways that some of the problem lay in her age. To have so much responsibility and to get so much attention so young wasn't easy. And while the rest of the royal family seemed to endure public attention, she courted it. Her smile, a combination of the shy, the alluring, and even the coquettish, guaranteed attention worldwide. Now the prince was taking second place to the first star the royal family had known since Edward VIII. It began to create divisions between the princess and court officials. A damaging rivalry was beginning.
It's only bad luck having to face all this, isn't it?
The birth of her children, far from mending the marriage, brought new problems. Afterwards, the princess suffered bouts of depression, suicidal impulses, bulimia. According to her account later, she got no help from the official hierarchy at Buckingham Palace. She remained an outsider. It was a turning point. She did with her life what she had previously done with her appearance. She reinvented herself, finding a new compassion and seriousness. With AIDS patients, her beauty and sympathy made a profound impression. But everything had changed within her marriage, too. And on a trip to South Korea, the distance between the couple was self-evident. The rumours were backed up by stories which the tabloids bought from friends, servants, and snoopers. And when they were in India, the princess, as conscious as ever of the cameras, insisted on posing alone for them at the Taj Mahal. We could all guess it for ourselves. The marriage was over. By now, it was open warfare. Andrew Morton's book, written with the help of the princess's friends and with her agreement, confirmed the rumours and more. News of the separation came in December 1992.
It is announced from Buckingham Palace that, with regret, the Prince and Princess of Wales have decided to separate. Their Royal Highnesses have no plans to divorce, and their constitutional positions are unaffected.
But it didn't halt the damage to the royal family. On the contrary, there was a new war of style. Without her, the prince was increasingly regarded by public opinion as stodgy, and the royal family as being out of touch. By contrast, the princess was encouraging the royal children to be classless, relaxed, children of the 90s. She seemed to dominate the times, just as she had dominated the style of the 80s. Things were changing, and she represented the new order. When she decided to speak to Panorama without the knowledge of the palace, divorce seemed unavoidable. But she took the opportunity to sketch out a new life and a new approach, a 1990s approach, perhaps, to serving people.
I'd like to be a queen of people's hearts in people's hearts, but I don't see myself being queen of this country.
Her relationship with Dodi Al-Fayed would certainly have caused a lot more controversy if they'd lived, if the intense media attention hadn't ended in their deaths. First, though, and now it seems almost prophetic, she stripped herself of her past. By selling her dresses, she was shedding the old life and preparing for a new one. Again, it was a gesture for the 90s. And she wasn't afraid any longer to court controversy in the campaign to get landmines banned. She used her pulling power with the media for an essentially political purpose, tied to a compassionate one. After going to Angola earlier this year, she'd won. The United States had decided to support a ban on the production and use of landmines. Altogether, the princess characterized our time. People were laying flowers outside her house today, not because everything she did was wise, but because it was all done from the heart. She was unforgettable, irreplaceable.
That's all today from the BBC Newsroom. The day that Britain lost a princess, and as John Simpson said, a young woman described by all to whom she reached out as irreplaceable. Good night.
In 10 minutes, this evening's special service from St. Paul's Cathedral.